afternoon. Good to see you all. Good to be with you once again. I must confess, I was working on this sermon for a long time, and I didn't have much to say. So if we ran out of stuff to say, it's because I didn't get it. But maybe it'll come to me today. So, four words to wisdom. We're talking about Proverbs and their usefulness in our life. Next one. What is a proverb? A proverb is a short, pithy, I just like this word, pithy. It's just a pithy word. A short, easy to remember, sticks in your head kind of saying that's in general use, right? That's what proverbs are, and we use them all the time. We see lots from them. Why should we listen to proverbs? Well, the bulk of proverbs in the Bible were written by this guy, King Solomon, and he was a very smart guy, very wise person. And there she came. Where's the woman of God? The two women who came to him, and they were arguing because both of them had a child, and one of the children had died, and they both said it's the one remaining child is my child. And Solomon came up with this wise solution of saying, okay, then we'll just cut the baby in half. And the real mother, of course, said, oh, don't cut my baby in half. It's better for it to live and go to the other woman than for me to. And so he was wise enough to solve an unsolvable problem like that. He had all sorts of wise stuff to say, and the book of Proverbs is full of his wisdom. The book of Ecclesiastes is full of his depressing wisdom. And overall, though, there's lots of stuff we can learn from him. Especially, we should learn to stop somewhere before we have 300 wives. So, Solomon, wise guy, made some bad mistakes, but his best stuff is recorded in the book of Proverbs. Lots of good stuff. How do we deal with Proverbs? Well, we've got to remember that Proverbs are not exactly like commands. They're not intended to be absolutely universal. We base our life on them, but we don't get upset when they don't exactly work out, right? This is a good example, two Proverbs that say the opposite. And so we've got to think of how to apply it in the right context. I think that's, apply it in context. Use it in the right situation. The other one that comes to my mind is there's a proverb that says, train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. And we know of people who raise their children to follow Jesus, and when they're old, those children leave the faith and never come back. Does that mean the proverb is wrong? No. The proverb is still true. Raise your children to follow Jesus. And generally, they will follow him. But sometimes, we know human sin overwhelms some of these general principles. The general principle, of course, do all you can to bring them to know Jesus. But when one child falls away, that doesn't mean the proverb is wrong. It's still generally true. It's still how we apply it, how we use it in our daily life. So, we talked a little last week about a couple of mnemonics. Can anyone remember these ones? Either of these ones? Rend your heart and not your garments. Right, you heard that once or twice last week, and it's kind of stuck in your head, right, honey? Right? Or how about this one? Oh, what's that? Flat baba. Friend loves at all times, but a brother is born for adversity. Right? And it's worth doing some of those things. I hope you've stuck one or two of those verses from last week in your head. These are the ones about friends. Remember the key thing? Be careful about your friends because they are important in your life. Good friends love you no matter what. Sometimes a friend has to tell you the honest truth, and we don't like to hear it, and we know that's what a good friend does. And remember, ultimately, though, the Bible tells us there is a better friend than any we can find here, and he's the friend who sticks closer than a brother. So that was last week. This brings us to the key verse. Lots of people would say this is the most important verse in the book of Proverbs. And it might be. Shall we read it together? If you really want to gain knowledge, you must begin by having respect for the Lord. But foolish people hate wisdom and instruction. Proverbs 1:7. Now, let's start at the very beginning. It's a very good place to start. When you read, you begin with A, B, C. When you sing, you begin with Do, Re. You know this song, right? Well, I was looking for this on to find this little clip from the Sound of Music. Watch this one. Oh, we're going to the next song.
Sounds good.
We'll play the we'll play the whole thing later. Is that okay?
Yeah.
That's good. Go on. Yeah, bring your lights back. I love those flash mobs. But the key thing there was, when you read, you begin with ABC. That's the start of reading, right? And when you sing, you start with Do, Re, Mi. And when you want to be wise, you begin with respect for the Lord, okay? That's where it starts. That's where it has to start. Just like those other things have something that you can't read without ABC, and you can't sing without Do, Re, Mi. Well, some of us do sing without Do, Re, Mi, but you can't sing well without Do, Re, Mi, right? And if you want to be wise, if you want to have wisdom, you must start with respect for the Lord. If you care about being a wise person, a person who does the right thing in the right situation, if you care about that, you've got to start with respect for the Lord. Next page. The old translation, the King James translation of this says, "The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge." I don't like that whole translation. The words have changed in meaning. It's not an accurate translation for today. Because these words, the fear and knowledge, are problem terms. They're not accurate. They're not the words we use anymore. Right? And that's why the way I talk about it is the wisdom... Go back. So that's why instead of fear, I use the term respect. And why instead of knowledge, I use the term wisdom. Because 500 years ago, when the King James Version was translated, fear meant what we mean by respect nowadays. And knowledge meant what we mean by wisdom. Okay? So those words have changed. But interestingly, knowledge, before it meant knowledge, used to mean wisdom, and then it became to mean, now it means knowledge. Things change, right? So these are problem words, and I want to make sure you understand them fairly. So let's go to the next page and compare fear and respect. Okay? Understand what fear and respect are. First, we're going to give you a definition, and then we're going to give you some examples to figure out. Fear means to realize that something can hurt you, so stay far away from it. Okay? When you're afraid of something, you know that thing can hurt you, so you keep as far away from it, you keep a big distance between you and it. Okay? And there are things we should be afraid of. We're going to see that for some examples. But it's not the same as respect. Respect means to realize that something can hurt you. Same part, right? Realize that something can hurt you. Realize that something can hurt you. But respect means after you know that thing can hurt you, be careful when you're around it. You treat it carefully, right? You don't stay away from something you respect. You stay close to something you respect. You use it, it's a good thing in your life. But fear, when you're afraid of something, the best thing to do is put a big distance between you and it. When you respect something, it can hurt you just as much as something you fear, but you are careful, and there's benefits to being near it, so you stay near it, right? Here's some examples. I think you'll get it from this. For example, an axe. Should we fear an axe or respect an axe? Respect. Yeah, I think you should respect an axe. I mean, I guess if there's a crazy axe murderer holding an axe chasing you, you should fear it. But that's not normally what we think of. We think of an axe that you're holding and there's some wood and you want to cut it. And you shouldn't fear it, but you should respect it. Right? Let's move it. There. Okay. How about this then? What is this? It's a tornado. Should you fear or respect a tornado? Yeah, you should fear a tornado. Because if it comes to where you are, it will suck you up along with the cows and the bricks and you'll die, right? It will be a horrible, painful way to die. So let's move this over to fear. stay away from it. Now, my hometown had a tornado many years ago, and there are still people who are afraid when the sky turns dark. Oh, it's a tornado. And, I mean, you don't have to be completely paranoid about it, but if you see a tornado coming towards you, go somewhere safe. Don't go underneath the bridge. And if you're ever in America in Tornado Alley, lots of people can tell you to go underneath the bridge. It's the safest place. It's the worst place you can go, so don't do that. Get down in a ditch or lower is better than... Anyways, fear a tornado reasonably. How about a fire? Fear it or respect it? If you fear a fire, there it is over there. Will you get very warm over here? I'm afraid of the fire. No, to get any benefit from the fire, you have to go close to it. But you still have to respect it. You probably don't want to be, you know, dancing wildly around it, or, you know, hopping on one foot and then falling into it, because you will get hurt, but you need to respect it. You know what? If you're a little kid, young child, you need to fear it. So I didn't move it all the way to respect. I just kind of put it over in that zone. Right? How about a teacher? Well, some of us, when we were in school, and some of us are still in school, want to be a long distance from our teachers, but that doesn't mean you should fear them. You respect them, and you can learn from them, so you go close to them, right? You learn from them by being close to them. So, put it over in respect. Ah, Grizzly? You should fear bears. Wild bears. I mean, if it's in a zoo with a wall or a fence between you and it, you don't have to be afraid of it. You should still respect it, because if you're dancing on the edge of the fence and you fall in, it will still eat you. But a wild bear, you should be afraid of it. You don't know if it's a mother and it's got babies around, and then they will just go crazy on you. You can't tell the difference between a grizzly and a black bear. Trust me, just assume it's a grizzly and it's going to come and eat you. So you should fear wild bears. Chickens?
Fear.
Fear? Yeah, they'll peck at you, I guess. You certainly can't respect a chicken. I don't think there's any way to respect a chicken. So we'll move it under fear. You don't have to be too afraid of it. So. How about God? Now, he can hurt us. So should we be afraid of him? No, he can hurt us. So we should respect him. We should go close to him, recognizing that he could destroy us, but that he chooses not to. And so we approach close to God in our respect, not a fear of him, but a respect for the fact that he truly can destroy us. But Jesus said, don't worry about anything else. Worry about he who can destroy your soul. Right? And that's God. But we don't have to fear him. We just recognize that he loves us, and he can choose to punish us, but we respect him and we treat him with the respect he deserves. Got the difference between fear and respect? Okay, let's move on to knowledge and wisdom. We got the definitions here. Knowledge means you know the facts about something. You know facts. I don't know if you know this, but I love knowing lots of useless little facts. We'll get to that in just a second. Wisdom means you know how to apply the facts about something. Knowledge means you know details and numbers, but wisdom is applying those facts. Scott, let's check if we know knowledge. Quiz time. First one. When was Hangul developed? Anyone? You heard it in Sunday school, you're not allowed to answer. 1443, you're the first person of the hundreds of people I've asked who knew the correct answer. 1443, early 1444. You have knowledge about Hangul. Well done. Really, I asked all of my students, including history majors, and none of them knows the number. It just drives me crazy because I love Hangul. It's a beautiful writing system. Next. Name the 12 apostles. How old can we do that one? Peter. John. Paul. No. I'm Andrew, James, Luke, not Luke, no,
Mark.
No, not Mark, Thomas. It's really a long time ago I taught this in Gem A. it's really easy to remember them. There's Peter and Andrew, and James and John, and James and Matthew, who might be brothers. Those are three sets of brothers. Then there's Philip and Nathaniel, who are friends. And then there's two Judases. And then there's two guys with the dot in the middle of the name, Simon the Zealot and Thomas the Twin. And there you've got 12. Okay, keep going. What does LED stand for?
Light emitting diode.
Light emitting diode, yes. You're doing much better than the Sunday school artist. Next one. How many times bigger is Canada than Korea? The cheaters who heard it in Sunday school. 100 is the correct answer. 100 times bigger. Yeah. What does atonement mean? Oh, there's a theological term. It tells you right here. At one. It means we're at one. We're friends with Jesus. We've been atoned. It means we've been made one with him again. Okay, next one. What is the root meaning of the word pastor? Yeah, shepherd. It's the same as Korean, right? Omsa means someone who deals with sheep. Same thing. And finally, if the right angle triangle has two short sides that are 3 and 4 meters long, how long is the other side?
Five.
Good answer. If you remember your Pythagorean theorem, good. Your knowledge, you're doing okay. Let's keep going. Let me explain one more way to understand the difference between knowledge and wisdom. I have a friend who spoke very good Korean. And he can say this in perfect. Oh, thank you, please. I do not enjoy. I got this written out here. Ah, Kamsa Hamni Baman, Kinchina Nije Man, Mago Til Gil Da Jusedo Dwinda. Isn't that beautiful Korean? Our friend could speak that with no problem, a foreigner. But you know what? I can speak better Korean. Because while he was saying that, I would say, kimchi juseo, and people would realize, I understand the value of kimchi. Anyone who says this, no matter how perfect their Korean is, they don't understand Korea if they think that this is a polite thing to say in Korea. You should say, please give me some more kimchi, right? Just say, kimchi, and it's better than this beautiful Korean, because we know that kimchi should be eaten, should not be said no thank you to. Right? This is applying my little bit of knowledge in a wise way. And this, my friend, had lots of knowledge, but he wasn't wise enough to just always say, thank you for the kimchi. Right? Wisdom is applying your knowledge in a reasonable and proper situation, in the right way. So, the Bible tells us this in James. If any of you needs wisdom, you should ask God for it. He will give it to you. Don't just listen to the word, to the Bible. You fool yourselves if you do that. You must do what it says. You can know all there is to know about the Bible, but unless you apply it, you're not acting wisely. Suppose someone listens to the word, but doesn't do what it says. Then they're like a person who looks at their face in a mirror, and after looking at themselves, they leave. Next one. And right away, they forget what they look like. But suppose someone takes a good look at the perfect law that gives freedom, at the Bible, and they keep looking at it. Suppose they don't forget what they've heard, but they do what the law says. Then this person will be blessed in what they do. If you want wisdom, start with respecting God. Knowing that he can destroy you if he wanted to. He chooses not to, and so draw close to him, and draw close to his word, and do what it says. Do what it says. Okay? That's what wisdom is. Real wisdom is applying the things the Bible tells us to do. Don't be a fool who says, I don't want correction, I don't want to grow, I don't want to learn more, I don't want to be more wise. Instead, be a wise person who starts with respecting the Lord, respecting God for all he can do, and then listening to what he says and obeying what he says. That's what a wise person does. That's what a person whose life is significant does. They obey the word. They read the word, they obey the word, they do what it says. They respect the Lord, and that brings them to a place of wisdom. Let's pray and finish with the Lord's Prayer as we always do. Father in heaven, thank you for your word that brings us wisdom. There's so much life and light in your word, so much truth that shows us the way to live. Well, thank you that because of it, because of what we learn from it, we can be wise people. There's all sorts of good wisdom around the world, Father, but the best of it comes from your word, and it applies directly to so many situations in our life. Father, we need wisdom, as James says, and so we ask you for it. Father, I ask for it for myself, and I ask for it for each person here. I pray that you would give us wisdom to make us people who impact the world, same way that Solomon did, and people saw how you had blessed him through his wisdom. Father, let our wisdom come from you and be shown to the people around us and be an example of what God can do with just ordinary people. Father, thank you for each person here. Father, help us to become wise. Father, we pray this as Jesus taught us to pray, saying, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Okay, a couple of announcements.